Well, good morning, everyone. It is good to see you. Good to have you here today. We're excited about what the Lord's going to do, and we're excited about this opportunity to worship you. Welcome to First Baptist Church in Morgan City. We're glad you're here today. If you're visiting with us for the first time, we encourage you to take a visitor information card. It's in the back of the pew in front of you, and fill it out. Make sure you either put it in the offering plate later on when it comes by or hand it to myself. I'd love to meet you and greet you myself. My name's Tracey Smith. I'm pastor here. For those of you who are tuning in through Facebook Live, thank you for worshiping with us remotely, and we are praying for you and hope to see you soon. We got a few announcements we're going to make at the end of the service. A couple of big events coming up. Of course, the concert. We are called Friday night. I'll let you know about how you can help out with it, how you can be involved in it, and how you can help us to get the word out. The other big announcement is today is the last Sunday of the month. We will pick up our monthly benevolence offering at the end of the service. There'll be a couple of ushers with the offering plates back there. That goes to help out people with needs here in our community in different ways. So thank you for supporting it. But our main reason is to worship, and we want to get right into that. So we'll do the more announcements later on at the end of the service. We are ready to see what the Lord has in store for us. We've been looking forward to this day. All week we've been getting ready for it. We've been having some special music ready, and we hope that you will please join us in worship and just pour your heart out before the Lord and thanking Him for what He's done. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and we'll begin our worship service. Father God, we thank You so much for this day, Lord God. This is the day that You have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Lord, what an honor it is to be here today, to exercise our freedom to worship You in whatever way we choose, Lord God. I know that there are a lot of people in this world that do not choose to worship You, and that is our goal, is to let You be known to the world around us, Lord God. Our hope is to see more people in here celebrating the risen Savior, finding out about what He has done for them, and just acknowledging You as their one true creator, Lord God, in this time of worship. We commit this time to You, Lord God. We commit the songs to You. As our voices cry out together, Lord God, in one accord, I pray that it would just be a sweet, sweet sound to Your ears, Lord God. Let our worship be our sacrifice that we bring today. And Lord, as the word is spoken of here in a little while, as we read Your word, Lord, help us to not just be hearers of the word, but doers as well. I pray, Lord God, that we'll take what we hear today, both in worship, in song, and worship in the study of Your word, and apply it to our lives. And just see and hear what Your Holy Spirit has to say to us. And we just thank You in advance for what You're going to do, and we commit this time to You. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. In Psalm chapter 100, verse 1 says, "Shout to the Lord, all the earth." Are we on earth? Are we part of earth? We're here, right? Let's shout to the Lord today as we worship. Would you stand as we sing?
Oh,
As we continue, you can sit down for a minute. As we continue, in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 13 gives us some instructions. And as our pastor has taught us, when you begin the verse with therefore, you need to know what it's there for, right? This verse is one of those. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, stand. Are you ready to stand? This is really what our Christian walk is all about. Standing for what Christ means in our lives. We're going to sing standing, stand up for Jesus, and you know we have to stand. So would you stand again? Chapter 12, verse 1. Again, Paul starts with therefore. So let's see what it's there for. He says, I urge you, brethren, in view of God's mercy, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Have you thought about that? When you worship him, when you're out doing things, do you have that in your mind that my body is not really mine, but it's his? And are we really aware of God's mercy? And that's why we exist, is because of his mercy. Let's sing, Come All Christians, Be Committed.
Come and join us.
In Philippians chapter 3, verse 14, Scripture tells us, I press on toward the good to win the prize. I press on toward the goal. I'm sorry. To win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. He has a call on each of us. And are we pressing on toward that goal? Or do we have our eyes set on something other than the goal God has for our lives? This is our offertory. Would you stand as we sing Higher Ground?
Lord, how we thank you for today. We thank you for the opportunity we have to come to your house and worship you, Lord. We ask you to be with us as we worship. We ask you to be with Brother Tracey as he preaches the message that you've given him, Lord. We pray for anyone here this morning that needs to make some sort of a decision for you. Ask you to bless these tithes and offerings and apply them to your kingdom's work here and around the world. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
Rise up, rise up and stand secure.
Little by little, we're taking ground. The battle is not always won all at once. Sometimes it is just one small victory at a time. But the one thing that I do know, the one thing that I've been emphasizing here lately, a larger army conquers more territory. And we hope that you will join us in the battle that we are in. The battle is for the souls of mankind. The battle is for strongholds to come tumbling down here in our community, reaching out day by day, little by little, doing what the Lord has called us here to do. It is our right, it is our privilege, it is our honor, it is our ability to move forward. Personal Lord and Savior. And so that is our goal here, reach the lost and make disciples. The United States of America was built upon religious liberties and freedoms. Our founding fathers were believers, and a lot of the guidelines that they set in place went parallel and went alongside of the laws of the Lord as well. So our Declaration of Independence states this. It says, we hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal and that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among those are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And so the earlier drafts of the Declaration of Independence state that they are unalienable rights. Maybe you've heard them called inalienable rights. The two words are interchangeable, and basically what that means is that they are impossible to take away or give up. Now, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Our culture has taken that to the extreme in the fact that they say, do what makes you happy. That's not always the case. You will know that we have certain guidelines and certain boundaries. Although we do live in a free nation, there are guidelines and boundaries that do restrict that freedom in some ways. And so take, for example, the Second Amendment. The Second Amendment clearly states we have the right to keep and bear arms. Now, I believe in the Second Amendment. I practice my Second Amendment rights. But even that Second Amendment right has certain guidelines and boundaries in the laws that are set protecting others from taking advantage of that. So we have the right to, if we choose to, own a firearm, but we do not have the right to go and use that firearm in any way and manner in which we choose. God's commandment clearly states that thou shalt not murder, thou shalt not kill. So not only does it fall within the guidelines of the Lord's laws, but it also falls within the guidelines of our rules and regulations and laws here in this country as well as to what you can do with those firearms once you own them. So your vehicle, for example, let's take that for instance. Your vehicle has a speedometer on it. Most of them go 100, 120, 120 miles an hour. That's the range on your speedometer. Even though your speedometer says you can go 140 miles an hour, you do not have the freedom and the liberty to drive 120 or 140 miles an hour anytime you choose. You get up in the morning, 8 o'clock, and you go through one of these school zones at 120 miles an hour, you'll find that out pretty quickly that, hey, even though my car can do that, I should not have done that at that time. You go over our bridge, it's been under construction for about a decade now, it seems like. Looks like it's coming to a close. Looks like they're in the cleanup mode. Hopefully it'll be opened up here before too long. But 50 miles an hour has been the speed limit over that bridge ever since I've been here. But if you drive over that bridge 120, 140 miles an hour, there's typically a Morgan City Police Department cruiser sitting right there at the foot of the bridge. You're going to be the one that he picks out of the crowd to say, he shouldn't have done that. Even though your speedometer tells you you can do that, you should not. A.W. Tozer had something to say. He said that the driver on the highway is not safe when he reads the signs, but when he obeys them. We're talking about religious liberties this morning. The issue with our American liberties in the pursuit of life, liberty, and happiness is that most of the times people take that happiness to the extreme. It too has its limitations, as we're going to see in the passage that we read this morning. But Article 17 is on the back side of your outline of our Baptist Faith and Message 2000 concerning religious liberties. The first two opening statements pretty much clarify everything that is contained in it and what we'll be talking about this morning. It says that God alone is the Lord of the conscience, and he has left it free from the doctrines and commandments of men which are contrary to his word or not contained in it. Church and state should be separate. The state owes to every church protection and full freedom in the pursuit of its spiritual ends. In providing for such freedom, no ecclesiastical group or denomination should be favored by the state more than others. Civil government being ordained of God, it is the duty of Christians to render loyal obedience thereto in all things, not contrary to the revealed will of God. The church should not resort to the civil power to carry on its work. The gospel of Christ contemplates spiritual means alone for the pursuit of its ends. The state has no right to impose penalties for religious opinions of any kind. The state has no right to impose taxes for the support of any form of religion. A free church and a free state is the Christian ideal, and this implies the right of free and unhindered access to God on the part of all men, and the right to form and propagate opinions in the sphere of religion without interference by the civil power. We've been given the right to exercise our religious liberty and freedom in any way we choose, but unfortunately, many people take that freedom and liberty for granted. You can tell by going outside today, seeing how many people are on the baseball fields or the football fields or fishing in the lake or in the deer stand or whatever the case may be. Not everybody exercises that religious freedom and liberty the way that they should, the way that the Lord ordained it anyway. So the letter that we're looking at today, the passage that we're looking at today, is written by the Apostle Peter. We'll be in 1 Peter chapter 2. If you have your Bibles, you can turn there. So Peter is writing, most people believe, from Rome to the church that is in Asia Minor, which is what we now know as the area of Turkey. He is encouraging them during a time of extreme persecution. Nero is the ruler of Rome. He is taking over basically that part of the world. But Peter begins this passage by addressing the beloved or the dear friends that he has at this church. So when we start this passage off, he starts off by saying beloved, and we don't see that word beloved again until chapter 4, verse 11. This constructs what most theologians refer to as an inclusio. You've heard me refer to them as bookends. So what he's saying is he starts off with one phrase, closes with another phrase, and everything captured within that text or that passage basically deals with the same topic or the same theme. And so the writer emphasizes here that a theme is repeated within a certain section or passage. He's emphasizing one certain theme, and basically it is submission. He talks about how we should submit to the laws of the land, the governing authorities, but God's rules always trump out those of the land as far as Christians are concerned. And it is indicated by referring to whom the writer is addressing. He addresses specifically to the church here at this time of the original writing, but the letter is also passed on to us. So how do we live godly in a godless society? It seems like the ones who are setting the laws in place are taking away our freedoms and liberties as Christians. When is the point do we quit or let God's rules trump out what the Lord has to say about things? Peter himself wrote in the book of Acts, he said in the book of Acts, when they were persecuted, they told him, don't preach the gospel. And he went back and he said, we ought to obey God rather than man when it comes to this particular situation. And so in our country as well, we've also been given the freedom of speech to go out and proclaim the gospel here in a religious setting, here in a church setting. I'm free to preach on whatever topic I choose. No one dictates the topics that I'm preaching on from one Sunday to the next. No one outside of our church, no one outside in a public realm or a government dictates what we teach in our Sunday school classes or the curriculums we choose. That is dictated by those within our church. That is all part of being an autonomous church. We set those things in order for our own. But Peter is writing here in ways that we should submit, some things that we should do, some ways that we should practice our religious freedom in a way that's going to impact the world around us. But how do we glorify God? How do we live godly in a godless society? What are some rights that we can exercise as far as Christians go, as far as abiding by the laws of the land? What are our limitations? Are there times when should we step outside of the box and say, you know what, this is what God is telling me to do. I know that I have freedoms and liberties as an American citizen, but I also have freedom and liberties as a Christian to live my life in a way that the Lord is telling me to live. How do we glorify God with our lifestyles while maintaining a balance between submission to the governing authorities and exercising our Christian liberties as well? Let's all stand for the reading of God's word, and we'll draw out a few things from this passage that will maybe help us out with finding that balance. Remember, Peter's writing at a time when Nero's a ruler. He's persecuting the Christians. Later on in his letter, he talks about the fiery trials that they will go through. But here he teaches the church how to live before the world in a way that also glorifies God, and finding a balance between submitting to governing authorities and continuing to exercise your religious liberties. He said, beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. Therefore, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether to the king as supreme or to governors, as to those who are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. As free, yet not using liberty as a cloak or vice, but as bondservants of God, honoring all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, and honor the king. Father God, we come before you now, submitting to your authority, Lord God, our first and foremost priority. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. But Lord, we also live in a land where our example, our testimony, our obedience to those around us, and our ability to conduct ourselves in a Christ-like manner, Lord God, comes into play each and every day. So I pray that as we learn about how to exercise our Christian liberties while living here under the rules of those who govern over us, I pray, Lord God, that you'll set our minds at ease. You'll help us to find that balance.
And you will reveal to us through your word, Lord God, what you would have us to do as we do our best to live godly in a godless society. And we just ask all of these things in your most precious and holy name. And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated. So living godly in a godless society. Peter specified that they were living among Gentiles. He said that there are certain things that you should practice as Christians while you're also giving honor to the king and to the governors, those who are ruling supremely over you. He said there's a few things that you need to keep in mind as you strike out to find that balance of who you should submit to and when God's rules should trump the rules of the land. So the first thing he begs these people to do, he doesn't just implore them, he doesn't just ask them, but he begs them to remember this one main thing. Number one, this world is only a temporary place for the believer in Christ. Apostle Paul said that the sufferings of this present world are not to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. So not only does Peter indicate the specific group he is addressing by calling them beloved, but he also reminds them that we are sojourners, pilgrims, strangers, aliens. In other words, this world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. And so he says that if you can tolerate these things for a little while, you're going to receive an honor and a glory that is beyond all compare. In other words, because of our beliefs and the way that we exercise our religious freedoms and liberties, in this world right now, we should stick out like a sore thumb. We are typically the ones that are going against the grain of society. Sojourners, aliens, people who seem to be different than anyone else. So just a few verses before this passage in verse 9, he says that we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people. Some translations call them peculiar people. Some maybe just a little more peculiar than others. But talking to believers, he says, your ways, your actions, and by you exercising your religious liberties, you should look different. And you should also have the mindset that you're not here for all of eternity. This is just a little speck on your timeline. He says, this is just a very, very temporary home that you are going through. And if you can tolerate it, if you can do this, you can continue to have that mindset. This is going to be a whole lot easier while you're here. And so what Peter is emphasizing is this: you're only here for a short time compared to eternity. This is only your temporary home. But while you're here, your conduct should make a difference. And since it's your temporary home, you only have a short time to make a huge impact. He says that there are things that you should do intentionally. Number one, abstain. Abstain from fleshly lusts. Abstain from those things that the Gentiles are doing, that the ungodly society is doing. There are things that you should abstain from, and there are things that should dictate your guidelines of conduct while you're here for this short time. You're in the world, but you're only here for a short time. And you're in the world, but you should not be of the world. You should not act like the rest of the world. He said, and there's something different about you. There's something unique about you. You've been given a living hope that this world does not understand. You've been given a heavenly home that other people need to know about. And he said, while you're here, you need to make the best of it. Don't waste a moment. Exercise your religious liberty, exercise your religious freedom. but also take advantage of the religious, of the freedoms and the liberty that this governing authority has given you, your freedom of speech. We've been given the freedom to go out and talk to people about our beliefs. We've been given the freedom to go out and share verbally the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. But unfortunately, that is one of the freedoms and liberties that we have taken for granted. While we've been given the freedom and the liberty to exercise our right of speech, most of the times we as Christians choose to remain silent. But Peter is saying here, keep in mind, if you're going to find that balance, you've got to understand you're only here for a little while. Make the best of it. And here's the reason why. Number two, he also points this out. He says that as a Christ follower, you are a target to the believing world. Not only understand that this world is just a temporary home, but while you're here, while you're letting your light shine, while you're being the salt and the earth of the world, you then become a target for the unbelievers. You become a target for the godless society. In verse 12, he says, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evil doers, our peculiar ways, our ways that seemingly go against the grain of society, they have us labeled as an easy target. And when you stand up and you say, I'm a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm going to live my life in a certain way, they set their eyes on you, they set their sights on you. And just like in the days of Peter, you become ostracized, you become targets, you become easy pickings for the evildoers and the ones that do not believe. At the time, as I mentioned, that this was written, Nero was the ruler. Peter described the time for Christians, this is a time of fiery trials. And with the surrounding world consisting of heathen, paganistic devil worshipers, it made the Christians of that day a very easy target. They would blame crimes on them. They would blame the crumble of society. Everything that went wrong in that day and time, they believed it on. They blamed it on the Christians because they seemed to be passive and less aggressive. They knew about the teachings of Jesus Christ. They knew that Jesus said, if someone smites you on the right cheek, you turn to them and you give them the left cheek as well. And so they knew that with that passive attitude and with those teachings, with their peaceable spirit, they became very easy targets during that time. He says, to have your conduct honorable among the Gentiles. And for the early church and for us, the Gentiles, those who are not yet believers, they are on the watch for us to make some type of a moral slip up. They look at us, they watch our life, they watch our conduct, and they want to see one thing and one thing only. Are they really different than we are? They watch your life, they watch your conduct, they watch the way you speak, they watch the way you talk, they watch the way that you treat your family, they watch the way that we treat other believers, and they say, I want to know, is this real what they have? And you become an easy target for them to watch. They're asking these questions. They say that they're different. But you know, I don't think they act any differently than I do. So here's what you need to remember about that. Every Christian is an advertisement, either for Christianity, or unfortunately, they become an advertisement against Christianity. Even though we seem to be easy targets sometimes, what is our overall goal? Have we fully submitted to the Lordship of Jesus Christ? Is it dictated through our actions, our conducts, our words, our speech? Knowing that people are watching us, knowing that we are living our lives to please the Lord and to please Him alone, do they see a difference in us that makes them want to become a believer as well? Our Christian conduct should be so evident that it becomes a witness to the watching world. You have their full attention. Make the best of it. You have their full attention, and you're only here for a short time compared to all of eternity. You're just a sojourner. You're an alien. You're a pilgrim that's passing through. But while you're here, make the best of the time. And while these people are watching you, make as big of an impact as you possibly can. Act in a way that it leaves no doubt whatsoever that my Lord is real. I fully believe in Him. And He is the one that is guiding my life while I'm here. Make sure that there's no doubt in their mind whatsoever as to who you belong to. The next thing Peter points out here is that exercising your Christian liberty becomes a powerful testimony to those watching. He says that when they speak against you as evildoers, that they may, by your good works which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. When you exercise your Christian liberties, when you live out your life the way that the Lord is telling you to live, it becomes an extremely powerful testimony. You give them all the proof and all the evidence they need, not for you to receive the glory, but that you can say, look, it's not me that's doing this. It is the Christ who lives within me. And I'm not doing it for my glory. I'm doing it for His glory. And that then becomes your testimony in hopes of bringing them over to a belief in the Lord Jesus Christ, that one day they may glorify God with His life as well. How does this happen? How do we do this? He goes on to say in verse 13, he gives the key to all of this. He says, therefore, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man, but you do it for the Lord's sake. And therein is the key to all of this. God's will, God's way, His sake, His commandments trumps everything else that is pressed upon your life. He says you submit to the ordinances of man, but you remember that God's laws and His commandments are what overrides everything else in your life. Peter says to submit. And going back to what he said in Acts chapter 5, verse 29, he says we have to submit to some things. But he says, our standing order is that we ought to obey God rather than man. And here in 1 Peter chapter 2, he specifies that it's for the Lord's sake, or for the sake of the Lord, to honor His name. For His sake, on account of, because of His name. So the great commentator Matthew Henry states it like this. He says that the will of God is, to a good man, the strongest reason for any duty. A Christian must endeavor in all relations to behave himself so as to put to silence the unreasonable reproaches of the most ignorant and foolish men. He says, first of all, submit yourselves to the ordinances of man. But understand that they should never trump the commandments of God. And so your testimony is to remain focused, especially on the first commandment. God says, you shall have no other gods before me. In other words, love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. Love the Lord God with all your heart. If you're focused on that, your witness then bears testimony of who you belong to and the reason for your Christian freedom to pursue God's will. But what does following God entail? How does following God bear witness of my testimony that I'm living a life that glorifies Him? What does it mean? What is Peter trying to say here? Observe every ordinance of man, but yet do it for the Lord's sake. Live in the land, be of the world, follow the guidelines. But when the time comes, is there a time when it goes against God's will and God's governing over your life? The key there is to submit yourselves. Who are you submitting to? Do you have the ability in your life to submit to the laws of the land while you're here for this very short time? What is the goal? What is Peter saying that we need to do? Why are we here? Why are we living this life? Why are we here to exercise our religious liberties? Why are we here struggling to find that balance, abstaining from fleshly lusts, submitting to the Lord? What does it involve? What does it entail? How do we do that? Last point, number four, pursuing the will of God and experiencing freedom and liberty in Christ involves total submission and surrender. Peter says, beginning in verse 15, "For this is the will of God, that by doing good you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. As free, yet not using liberty as a cloak or vice, but as bondservants of God." Not bondservants to any other man. Not bondservants to any other government or authority. But he said, if you'll understand that you've been set free from the penalty of sin, if you will understand that the Lord Jesus Christ has freed you of your penalty of sin, you then become, because of your freedom, a bondservant of God. The lowest form of servant that was known in that time. But he said there is a goal, an overall goal, to silence the opposition by surrendering to the Lord. Peter says that you are free. You're free from the penalty of sin. You don't have to worry about that anymore. But you are not to use that freedom as a cloak or a veil. In other words, don't put on a facade or be a hypocrite. He says, let it be real. Let it be obvious. Let it be known to this outside world that I love the Lord with all my heart, all my soul, all my mind, and my strength, and nothing is going to change that. Religious liberty or Christian freedom is exercised through spiritual discipline. He says you've got to submit yourself. You've got to submit yourself to the Lord. Your goal for all of that is to do good in order to put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. So how do I do that? How do I totally surrender to the Lord Jesus Christ? Jesus said to seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. How do I do that? Each and every day. The first step is committing your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. Whenever you step out in faith and say, I'm now a believer, I have been saved from my sins, I have been set free by the Lord Jesus Christ, but because of that freedom, I'm now walking in accordance to what He commands me to do. I no longer have the flesh dictating my life. I'm no longer living to serve self, but I have become that bondservant to the Lord Jesus Christ. What He says I do, where He says to go, That's where I go. I have submitted to the Lordship of Jesus Christ and to Him alone. That is how I exercise my religious freedom and my religious liberty. But even it has its boundaries. Even that, it has its guidelines. It starts off with the Ten Commandments. Being free from your sin debt doesn't give you a get out of jail card free to go and do whatever you want to whenever you want to. But it all involves surrender to the Lord. I wake up in the mornings. I totally surrender myself to the Lord Jesus Christ, first and foremost. I'm free because I have surrendered. My freedom does not mean that I'm free to do as I want. My freedom does not mean that I'm free to do as I want to or like to do, but it involves doing what I ought to do that will bring the most glory to my Lord, Master, and Savior for the glory of God. Religious liberty does not involve what I want to do, but what I ought to do. God alone is Lord of the conscience, just like this article stated as it began. And He has left it free from the doctrines and commandments of men, which are contrary to His word or not contained in it. Religious liberty does not involve what I want to do, but what I ought to do. It doesn't give you free range. It says you are now a bondservant to the Lord Jesus Christ, not doing what you want to do, but doing what He wants you to do. And so as citizens of the United States of America, our rights are unalienable. However, our freedom in Christ is eternal, and God's commandments are never changing and for our benefit. Some say that there is no such thing as absolute freedom. But Jesus said that whom the Son sets free is free indeed. So that's my question for you today. Has Jesus Christ set you free? Has He paid your sin debt in full? Have you submitted to Him as Lord of your life? If not, then what's holding you back? What is keeping you from doing that? Many of you are familiar with the name Jim Elliot. If you've ever seen the movie, The Point of the Spear, The Tip of the Spear, he was killed on the field as a missionary. Jim Elliot has several books about his life. Probably one of his most famous quotes ever, he said this. He says, "He is no fool who gives up what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose." If you remember that word, unalienable or inalienable means something that you cannot lose or be separated from. What Jim Elliot was saying was, is that you have Christian liberties. You have Christian freedoms. You have things that you cannot be separated from, things that you cannot have taken away from you. But there are some things that you will have to give up to experience that freedom and that liberty. Your freedom as an American, it gives you freedoms to do certain things. Your freedoms as an American, they're free to you. Everything that you experience right now, every amendment, the Declaration of Independence, every right, every freedom that you have right now hasn't cost you a thing. But somewhere along the way, someone did have to pay for it. Someone did have to give a sacrifice for those freedoms that you now experience. Someone had to fight for them. Someone had to lay their life down for those freedoms that you experience and exercise as a citizen of the United States. Some of you here, I know that you've been in the service, and thank you very much for your service and what you have done. You sacrificed time away from your family. You had to sacrifice some of your freedoms and liberties to go and serve your country and to provide for us the freedom that we now enjoy as citizens of the United States of America. For some, those freedoms are free, but for some, those freedoms cost them everything. They laid down their life in the line of duty for us to be free. Your salvation is also free to you. The gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. It doesn't cost you a thing. And Jesus said that whom the Son sets free is free indeed. But within that freedom, there are certain constraints. Once you become a believer, God says you can't just live your life any way that you want to now. Now that you are mine, I want you to look just like my Son, Jesus. He says, I've set you free from the penalty of sin. The Bible says that the wages of sin is death. Sin cost you something. Sin cost you a separation from the Lord Jesus Christ. But in order for that relationship to be restored, God said, I'm going to pay for it. It doesn't cost you a thing, but it cost his precious Son, Jesus, everything. And Jesus laid down his life and shed his blood to pay your sin debt and set you free. It doesn't cost you a thing, but it cost him everything. He willingly laid down his life to set you free. Now, would you give your life back to him in order to serve him? So Jesus asked this question in Mark chapter 8, verses 36 through 38. He says, what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world yet loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? What is it that you are holding on to right now that is keeping you from pursuing the Lord? What is it that has you chained up and in bondage, keeping you from experiencing true freedom and liberty in the Lord Jesus Christ? Why don't you let him set you free today? Why don't you experience true freedom in the Lord Jesus Christ? True Christian freedom is when you lay down all of the things of this world. Just like Peter said, abstain from those fleshly lusts. Don't be like the Gentiles. Don't be like the unbelievers. True Christian freedom is when you lay down all of the things of this world and kneel down at the feet of Jesus and confess him as your Lord, Savior, and Master of your life, and you surrender everything you have to him. Would you do that today? If you've never given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, what's holding you back? What is keeping you bound up? What is keeping you from experiencing that true freedom that only he can bring? Mark Buchanan had this quote to say. He said, the opposite of a slave is not a free man. It's a worshiper. The one who is most free is the one who turns the work of his hands into a sacrament, into an offering. All he makes and all he does are gifts from God, through God, and to God. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Are you free today? Or are you enslaved to sin? Are you pursuing after the things of this world, and they're keeping you from pursuing the Lord? Then you're not free. If the things of this world have you bound up, if you're pursuing after a career, if your goal is relationships with other people, if your goal is material possessions, then this world has you enslaved. Jesus said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then all of these things will be added unto you. What is your confession today? Have you ever confessed Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Have you ever said, God, I know I'm a sinner, and I know that sin is separating me from you, and I don't want to be a slave to sin anymore? The Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 6 clearly said that sin shall not have dominion over you. But it's only through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ that you can be set free. Paul says in Ephesians chapter 2 that by grace you are saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It is a gift of God. God freely gives you that gift of salvation. And here's one thing I want you to know for sure. God loves you just the way you are, with all of your scars, all of your bruises, everything that this life has thrown at you, God loves you just the way you are. But he doesn't want to leave you like that. He wants to save you. He wants to set you free. And he wants to make you look more and more like his son, Jesus Christ. And that's the religious liberty and Christian freedom that we have. So would you let Jesus Christ set you free today? Say, Brother Tracy, I don't know how to do that. All you do is say, God, I want you in my life. God, I know that I'm a sinner. I know that my life is not pleasing to you. And I want you to make an eternal difference in my life. So I ask you to forgive me of my sins, Lord. I fully submit to your will and your way for my life. And from this moment on, I want to follow you as my Lord, Master, and Savior, to do what you tell me to do, to go where you tell me to go, and to be who you created me to be. And God, I ask you now to set me free of my sins. And he'll do that. In just a moment, when the music begins to play, we're going to have a time of invitation. If that's a decision that you want to make, I'll be right here in front. I'll be more than happy to show you in God's Word what it means to become a Christian. Or whatever the Lord is leading you to do, the altars will be open. If there's an area in your life that you have yet to surrender to the Lord Jesus Christ, I ask you to give it to him today. He can do more with your life than you ever will. So in just a moment, as soon as we stand, when the music begins and we begin to sing, don't hesitate. Make that move and let him know that you want to do business with him today. Father God, we commit this time to you. We commit this time of invitation to you, and we just pray, Lord God, that if there's anyone here that does not know you as their Lord and Savior, today would be the day that they would begin that relationship with you. And Lord, if there's anyone here that you're asking them to do something in specific, Lord, and they have not said yes, I pray that you would change their hearts And help them to fully surrender, Lord God, so they can experience a freedom like they've never experienced. And we just ask it all in the mighty and powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's all stand as we begin to sing.